It's good to see you again. I want to talk to you today about a very underutilized set of data that is out there that most prospectors don't use. And when even the name gets mentioned, many of them run like cockroaches when the light gets turned on in the kitchen. And that word is geophysics. Geophysics is, you don't really have to know how it's generated or the maths behind it, which is horrendous, but it is an invaluable tool. It's like having your eyes below the surface when you can see what's going on where the surface shows you nothing. Now, the most common set of data that's available for prospectors and pretty much anyone, mining companies, whatever, to use that's out there and published by the Department of Mines, or DMPE here, is the Magnetics, Aeromagnetics RTP. P stands for reverse dipole. And it's available here under the geophysics column, and I've turned it on here. And so what we can see, the geophysics down here, oops, there it comes. It covers pretty much the whole state from north of the Kimberley to south of Augusta, east to west, blah, blah, blah. And what you can see is that it is a complicated mass of colors, reds, purples, all the way through to dark blues. The colors are actually a spectrum of aeromagnetic values. Okay, just to fill you in on what aeromagnetics is. The values shown here are the magnetic values of the rocks that the instrument passed over. And so the more magnetic a rock is, in other words, the more iron it contains, then the higher it shows up on the magnetics. So ultramafic rocks, banded irons, etc., stand up as highs. Granites, on the other end of the spectrum, have low iron content, and they show up as blues. So knowing that information, you can see, like just in the center of the screen here, we've got some bands of red coming around, swirling around zones of dark blue, which means that it is non-magnetic, very non-magnetic, and some intermediate colors out here. And you can see streaks and twists and turns and stuff. And what this is showing you is how the rocks have been twisted and deformed and intruded into and faulted and everything over the last 2 point whatever it is billion years of WA's geological history. This data here is collected by an aeroplane that flies back and forth across the sky, basically. Usually flown at a height of about 50, 60, sometimes maybe a little bit more meters above the ground. Usually on traverses about 200, maybe a little bit more spacings from one run to the next. And it's all stitched together and put it together in an image. Now it's a big image. Each pixel represents 40 by 40 meters on the ground. Okay, so it's not high resolution. You're not going to find individual stones, but it's enough to show where major rock types are trending. Okay, so what I've got on here is, where has it gone to? I've got a couple of points I wanted to show you guys. Now, these spots, nothing special, as in, there's one just south of Coolgardie, one out here near Cal. Now, so if we bring back our geophysics, and these are the two pins that I've made. So we can zoom in on this particular point out here, and you can see some really twisted up zones of rocks and whatever. So when you see areas like, now as an example, like these sort of rounded zones, like these sort of things, they usually represent granitic intrusions that have come up and pushed up into the surrounding rocks. And you can see how they've bent these rocks, and these rocks have wrapped around the outside of these. There's one coming up and through here, and it's completely twisted this existing rock unit between this sort of intrusive and this intrusive here. Yes, it does require a little bit of artistic license. It does require a little incy-bincy little bit of getting your eye into it. But the more you look at it, the more it'll start to make sense. So back into this zone up here, I'm going to turn on the geology of the 1 to 100,000 mapping as well. So this is the standard geol survey WA mapping, 1 to 100,000 scale mapping. So you can see they've got a number of units mapped in here, alluvial channel out here. So what we can do here, and again, I'll move my spots to the top so we can see them, they turn back up again. And I'm actually going to turn up the geophysics, which we can see here. It's actually underlying the 1 to 100,000 mapping. And we can actually start to play the opacity game. And as you start to see this, you can start to see how this unit out here comes down here, wraps around and continues out here. Now, if we move the map across, You can see the same unit is heavily busted up, and it wraps around here and then goes up through here and up to here and possibly goes up there, but then gets pretty much stoked out by the granites. So if we turn that mapping back on, you can see that there's no mapping out here, and there's no real indicator that this actually same unit wraps all the way around there. And so you may say, well, so what? So let's, just for the fun of it, go and turn on the gold locations are aligned with the rock tops. So you can see how this comes down here, goes across here, up here, and up through here. And there's a possibility there's some more bits that may be up here, which are just actually not mapped. And so you can see how handy the geophysics is for just picking up places where you couldn't see what's under the ground. Now, if we zoom over to someplace over here, for example, you can actually see, you get it to a particular point in the opacity levels, you can almost get like a 3D effect. And you can see how this unit comes all the way down here and very high anomalous values along here. I'm not talking gold, I'm talking geophysics values. And you can see how you can start to see the geophysics is lining up very nicely with the mapping. Okay, these cross-cutting structures across here, these are protozoic dikes. They came in a long, long time after the gold mineralization, and they just cut across the countryside. So if we turn that one off and you zoom out a bit, you can see, and I'll knock the gold back a bit as well, you can see how the state is pretty much just hammered left to right by these protozoic dikes. And some of them are very big. We're talking hundreds of meters wide in some places. I want to go to my other interesting spot. Now, you can see in here how as I showed before, there was a spot we had. It was very wrapped around. And when you start looking closely to the data, you can start to see some weird artifacts in the data. Like, what is this thing? Square shapes, squares, straight lines, whatever, generally do not occur in nature. Yeah, so what caused that? And that looks like an oddball thing as well. So if we bring back the 100,000 mapping, nothing on the surface jumps out, but we're looking closer. There is a bit of a square drawn there. Okay, so if we go to Google Maps, turn that one. Unfortunately, I'm going to have to knock these ones back. Knock that one back too, and knock this one back. Boom, that's what we're looking at. So sometimes you can pick up a mullock dump or a tailings dam from a existing gold mine. And you can see how this gold mine sits right on top of this high in the band coming through here. Now, there's a couple of interesting things happening here, which is really why I wanted to come in. That was more of a novelty than anything else. What we can see is there's a particular unit that comes down along here, and then it seems to break and continue along down here. Then we've got another one that comes along here and breaks and continues along here. So it doesn't take much imagination to say there's some sort of break that runs through there. This side of the break has moved this side, and that side of it has moved that way. Now, if we extrapolate our thinking, you could say maybe the fault goes all the way through there. And if you've got one, there's most probably others. And so this is how you can look for faults that occur in the ground that are not mapped anywhere else. Now, I haven't checked, and this is most probably going to prove me an idiot, but let's go and have a look at the structures and turn on the half-minute structures. You can see those are the currently existing map structures for the 1 to 1.5 million, and the 100,000, there's no structures coming through there in this orientation. Plenty of small ones along here, running through there, lots going through this place. And you can use that as an example. You can see we saw there was a gold mine, there's the gold mine in there. Look at the structures intersecting this rock unit, and you can see why there was gold mineralization in here. I'm going to go down to Norseman. Okay, so let's turn on the geophysics and we'll turn on the 100,000 mapping. So what have we got at Norseman? We got this stonking big great protozoic dike coming through here. If we turn on our 100,000 mapping, you can see how that correlates. So we've got lots of granite out of the sides, some mafic in the middle, and some banded iron formations running up through here, hitting a ultramafic protozoic dike coming across here. Apologies for all the geology terms. So let's zoom right in. And you can actually start to see how close the geophysics lines up with the banded iron. And it lines up very, very well. But what I wanted to show you was this zone here. Okay. So what this is here is you can see a whole bunch of major faults coming through the structure, the banded iron. So there's a fault coming through here. There's another fault coming through here. There's another fault coming through there. They've mapped this fault up here. And all the way down this line, there is faults cutting across the countryside. Now, if we turn on the gold, quite a good correlation between gold locations and fault. There's one there. There's one down there. There's a couple through here. So there's good correlations between the faults. And if you extrapolate some further out, you'll actually get to more well-known intersections out there. So what this is showing is that there's gold and fault correlations. So I hope that brief introduction to geophysics gives you some increased opportunity to find more gold. I believe it will, because geophysics in the prospecting game, a very underutilized tool. So what you need to do is you need to go and look at the geophysics in a particular area, turn on the gold locations, turn on the gold soil samples, and see where the correlations are. And can you see any of those lineaments coming through? And if you can see them, try either sketch them out or just take a mental note and see where else does that occur. If it occurs multiple times in that area and there's no soil samples on it, it could mean it's never been sampled before because no one else has ever found the fault before or even identified it before. Worth wandering over with your metal detector and going to have a look. So I hope this video has been of value. If it has, I'd love it if you could leave a like, a comment, or if you haven't subscribed, please hit that subscribe button. Thanks, guys, and we'll see you on the next video.